welcome to Contact. I'm Gloria Creighton, and we're here once again at the beautiful Anderson's Restaurant overlooking Falls Creek. My guest on today's show is well-known director and choreographer, Mr. Michael Mckim. Michael, welcome to the show. I might add, too, welcome back to Canada. You've spent the past 15 years directing, choreographing, and dancing in groups all over Europe.
That's right.
How does it feel to be back?
A surprise. It's an unusual change. You know?
Do you find the city's changed?
No.
No.
Well, you know, I've come back for a month or even up to 6 weeks periodically during the last 16 years.
So you've seen the changes in the buildings and influx of people?
I've seen the change sort of the buildings and what's construction or new buildings and some other things. The change I really see is, you know, the difference between Europe and Vancouver. That's a real change. Now, I don't know if that's a change that has developed since I've been away, or it's a change that's just cultural between these two.
Can you elaborate on that first?
I think the first thing, most clear thing, is the structure. Say, European people or businesses or a theater, it's all more structured. It's more blocks on top of each other, one over here or one over there. Here, at least on a very short time span. I've only been, you know, a couple of months here. It's everything seems a bit vague. Things cross one into the other.
Probably because it's a newer country, we don't have the tradition that
Europeans. It's the mentality.
It's the mentality.
I think Americans certainly and Canadians, we have a sort of a wider look at things. We don't just get fixed on one subject or one particular aspect of life. In Europe, I think the people become really into a position, you know, or a business becomes like a business, or a dance company is a dance company. Whereas, I think in our North American culture, people are a little bit more spread out in their mentality, if it makes any sense.
Yeah, it's a very interesting observation. It makes sense now that you mention it. I guess we don't notice it living here. And occasionally, you know, when you visit Europe, it's just to visit so you don't see it. But living and working there as you have.
But they both have the advantages and disadvantages. It's a bit frustrating in Vancouver, or let's not pick on Vancouver particularly, but it's hard to focus or fix on certain elements in life or situations on life. And in Europe, you can fix and establish contacts very quickly. But then they don't go anywhere, or they're very contained. So it depends on what you're doing or what you want to do.
Do you find people in Europe generally tend to have one job for most of their lifetime?
No.
And here people change careers more often, no?
Well, yes and no. People in Europe often have more than one job, or more than one. Then we must differentiate slightly, as I see we're going along in this conversation. I've lived in Italy, and I've lived in Switzerland, and I've lived in Belgium. And I've spent long periods in France and Spain. Now, the people in these countries are as different as, say, Germans are to Canadians. Mm-hmm. So when we speak about Europe, we also have to consider the very big differences there are in Europe. Like the difference between living in Rome and living in Zurich is night and day.
Right. North Americans tend to lump it all in one Europe. Europe is Europe.
I think if you take a trip to Europe, you won't.
Right. Anyway, let's get back to you and the European experience. Was it a good one?
Yes.
As an artist? In what way, Michael?
Well, I can't complain. I didn't really make any of my career here. So as far as my career goes, I enjoyed my career. And my career has gone very well. But it's happened in Europe.
Do you find that you had opportunities in Europe as a dancer initially that you would not have had here in Canada?
That's difficult to say, as I never really did it here. But I can say that the possibilities in Europe are infinitely greater.
Well, you had left the National Ballet and then went to a European company.
Yes, that's
and
right.
And was that a good choice, looking back now in retrospective? Are you glad that you did it?
Well, I don't look back and analyze that way. I left, that was it.
And you went on a voyage that took you into lots of interesting side streets and different companies.
Yeah, I guess when I left, I must have been 18, I think, maybe 19, when I went to Europe. And at that age, I was just, you know, I hadn't been there before, so that seemed like the best reason to go. It wasn't very well calculated or planned out career. But it was a good company, and it was an interesting opportunity, and the contract they offered me was good, and the money was good, and it was an opportunity to go to Europe. So I said, well, why not, you know?
Let's backtrack a bit and go back to the very beginnings and to how you got started in dance. When did you first get interested in ballet?
I was about 13, 14, relatively late, actually. Seriously.
So 13 is late?
Yes, for National Ballet, they start people at 10. Mm-hmm. I think that's a bit young, but they do start them at 10. Boys do start later, and it's not serious. But I think I really was serious when I was about 14, like I said. Before, so I used to take class like once or twice a week. This is not serious.
It's did your parents else. Send you initially? Is that how you got involved?
No.
Or is it something you wanted to do?
It was something I wanted to do. I was influenced, and I saw a production of Romeo and Juliet. And when I saw this, I was very enthusiastic and very excited, and I decided I would like to do that.
So at 13, you were taking class, 13, 14, 15. Was this difficult as a young boy? Did other boys say, was there a stigma attached to it, or did the kids in school give you a hard time?
Yes, sometimes. Sometimes. But I was actually perhaps more paranoid myself.
Were you?
Well, perhaps because one would anticipate these kind of reactions. You know, like, what's he doing? This guy is really strange and dancing and such things. But sure, there was some confusion, like a lot of people, you know, thought that's really weird and you shouldn't be doing those sort of things and that's not masculine. And reminds me, even once later, I was at the border and they would ask me, what's your profession? I would say, dancer. And they would say, yes, I know that, but what is your profession? What do you do for a living? So, you know, many people don't really see it as a career or a profession.
Now, that's in North America, isn't it? Is that
yes.
not different in Europe? More men dance?
Europe has a completely different outlook on the arts, completely. I wouldn't necessarily say that they are always more enthusiastic, but they are certainly much more respectful, let's say. And you can even go back to even Russia or some countries in the East Bloc. Well, what was the East Bloc? And these people really almost respect, you know, a little boy would like to be a fireman, a policeman, or a ballet dancer. They all sort of have the same status.
So is it changing in Canada now? Are more men getting into dance, more men going into ballet companies?
Could be. I think that the dance had a kind of little crescendo, let's say. This was in the time when you had Nureyev and Baryshnikov and a lot of big stars who were really very visual, and the public was seeing them and people were seeing them, and this changed I think the general public's attitude,
right.
And I think, you know, obviously younger kids and young boys, they would see these images and these impressions and they would decide that they would want to have that for themselves. That certainly was the case 5-6 years ago. I have a feeling it's going down. I think these big stars and these images are dropping away. They're retiring, or they want to do something else. And I think they're dropping away. So I think, in a way, we're going to have a little downslide mm-hmm. in these, you know, the yeah. younger people coming
in. Being
into
inspired,
this.
Looking for role models and that kind of thing.
Yeah.
Because, in fact, dance is, particularly ballet, is one of the most difficult for sports, as well as being an art.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what a lot of people don't realize.
Yeah.
I think a lot of men, once they start taking class, they realize, hey, this is much more difficult than any sport that they may have done.
Well, it's unusual.
It's unusual.
It's very unusual. It's a very unusual profession.
Let's get back to you. At 15, 13 you started. At 15, you went to audition for the National Ballet.
Yes, they had an audition here.
And you made it.
They gave me a scholarship. I went out there to Toronto. They had a residence. I stayed 3 years. I moved out of the residence very quickly, but took an apartment. But I did go to the school, I think it was 3 years. And then I was in the company a year. Then I went to New York, studied more,
right.
And then went back into the company a year. But this was occasionally, these were overlapping, these experiences.
What was the actual, you know, you made the audition, so many people are turned away. There's so many young people.
No, at that time, for boys was no problem.
No boys, no problem. Was it as rigorous as they say, Michael? You hear...
Rigorous?
Yeah, the audition. Did they put you through...
I don't remember.
...tests and...
Just a sort of a class.
What were they looking for? Is it body type, expression?
Oh, I don't know. The National Ballet usually has a very particular look that they do try to find, especially in the girls. The boys, they obviously can't afford the luxury of looking around and being so particular as the... there's so few boys. Now I know they have many, many more. Earlier, 10, 15 years ago, it was not the case. You know, they would take boys really, and unless there was something really seriously wrong.
What was it like for you at 15, leaving your school and your friends and as a teenager and going into a strict discipline?
Didn't
like
think
the
about
school?
It.
Did you miss
no.
your home?
I did miss Vancouver, actually, I must say. I've always had a strong desire to come back to Vancouver. I remember when I went to Europe, I decided I would go, let's say, a maximum of 5 years, and then I would come back.
And you stayed 15?
15, almost 16,
right.
actually.
Did you, looking back, do you regret those early years in, as a national? Do you wish you had had more of a normal teenagehood?
No.
Are there things that you feel you missed out on?
No. I don't think I missed out on anything, actually.
Great. That's lucky that you can say that.
I'm certainly.
Yeah.
I always find that a strange question, actually, because, I mean, that's what happened. And that's the way my life was at that time.
Yeah.
And perhaps I could always say, well, it would have been nice if this had happened, it would have been nice this. I should like to have had this or that, but somehow nothing would change even if I did say that, or I did want that. It would be, that's what happened.
What was a typical day like at the National Ballet School? You did academic subjects also, apart from the dance.
Yes. Oh, you know, I won't, an exact day, I can't tell you right now, but it would be...
Just to give us an
9
idea.
9 o'clock, there would be a class,
dance ballet class,
which would go on for about an hour and a half. Then there would be an hour of, say, English, then an hour of mathematics, and then an hour of history or some such thing. Then there would be perhaps another class, another classical ballet class. Then there would be perhaps another academic. And near the later part of the afternoon, there might be again a class, which could be a character, which is like Russian dancing or folklore, pas de deux class or some such thing.
And that would take you on to what time?
Well, like I said, I don't remember so well, but 6.
That's
6
a long
30.
Day. Much
yes.
longer than a regular school day is what I'm
sure,
saying.
Sure, but the kids had the same academic training. I mean, we had a very good school. It was considered a good school. But they would have within the whatever number of hours a school must have, you had the 3.5 to 4 hours of
dance.
And 3 hours is really almost the minimum for a young dancer to become a professional dancer.
So you got a very good base with the National, does provide
yes.
a good base.
Yes.
What do you call a good base for a dancer?
A good technique and a good teacher. Probably the most important thing really is to have a good teacher and a good school.
Okay, moving on from the National, you had two offers when you left the National Ballet. One was with a European company and one was with a modern company.
Right. That I've almost forgot.
You would have been a soloist with the modern company in Canada.
Well, I was a soloist also in Europe.
But starting off with the Ballet von Flanders?
Yes, that's
okay,
it.
I see.
They're
so you chose the Ballet von Flanders. Why?
Yeah. Well, I think I said so before. It was an opportunity to go to Europe.
To Europe, right.
And it was obviously a better company. And
how did it compare with the National?
Smaller. The National is a big classical company. They do big classical ballets as their base. Mm-hmm. I haven't followed them much lately, you know, so I really can't talk about that company very well. But they are, let's just say, the big classical company. And the company I went to, it was, I think we were 25 or 26. This is a small number for a
25 dance
company.
Is considered small.
Well, actually, now it's considered big as money becomes scarce. Yeah. Even 25 looks like a pretty impressive company. But most classical companies are from 55 to 80 or even more.
So it's a very costly production when one, say, mounts Swan Lake.
Sure.
You've got how many dancers in the corps, approximately?
Well, there I don't know. I should think more or less 25 girls. You know, these productions, they can be rearranged. They can be, I think in Baedere they have the same phrase of music 64 times, and each phrase of music represents one girl comes on, and they do a zigzag all the way across the stage, mm-hmm. and the original version is 64, so 64 times one girl, 64 girls, but very few companies do that, and the public would probably fall asleep anyways, so they do cut it down to 32. And that's by it. It's 32 times this zigzag.
So that's a lot of dancers, and I'm thinking 32 pairs of point shoes. And do they not wear one pair of point shoes performance, right?
Yeah.
They're finished after performance?
Most are.
Yeah, I'm thinking of the money that's involved.
That's a big problem for a lot of dance companies is the point shoes, because they are expensive and they do go fast.
And then you've got your orchestra costumes.
Yes. Oh, it's very expensive business.
And
the big classical ballets are very expensive, and you need to have a lot of tradition and experience, and it's another show. Whereas the Ballet of Flanders really was a smaller company, and for a dancer, these smaller companies are more interesting, as there were more modern choreographers were coming in there, and ballets would be for 16 people, and 16 people would dance.
So you had
Whereas
more.
The big companies, you have 85 people, and maybe 5 dance, but really dance,
right.
Let's say, because it would be the solo roles are really very important, and what comes after is not.
So you were with Ballet von Flanders for how many years, Michael?
4.
4 years. And you left to move on, why?
Well, I was becoming slightly bored with the company, and being like many dancers, just impatient to go on and try somewhere else.
And after Ballet van Flanders came Béjart.
That's it.
Ballet du XXe siècle.
Yes.
And lots of dancers would kill to dance with Béjart. What were your impressions?
Well, it's probably a slightly overrated thing.
Is it?
But it obviously is a very good company, and he's a very amazing man to work for. And the company travels a great deal. We would travel 9 months of a year, you know. So you did see a great deal of the world. And they were nice tours. We'd be like 1 month in Buenos Aires or 1 month in Tokyo. So it was not just a day here and a day there. You would really travel and really see things. And there was very busy schedule. It would be 30 performances in a month. So that's, of course, very important for dancers, that they dance and perform. You know, so when I speak that way, it's a signal that this is important, as many companies perhaps doing 30 performances a year, whereas we would do that many in a month, you know. So it was a very dynamic company, and there's a lot of very interesting people there. And as I said, working with this man, Maurice Béjart, is a very fantastic individual.
And you were doing solo work too with Béjart?
Yes. At the beginning, I suppose, in his company, there is actually no divisions, as many companies do have. He has just everybody is there. They obviously receive different money or different salaries, but there's no positions like corps de ballet and demi-soloist, half-soloist, soloist, principal, star, whatever. He doesn't really have those categories. They exist, obviously, in the performance, because some people will dance more than others, and some people will become better or are better, and they will take on that look, but they don't. They're not actually called that in their contract or on paper or in the program.
And was he not doing more modern work?
He is modern.
Yeah. So you didn't do any classics?
No, he didn't like classics. He had nothing to do with classics.
But it's modern ballet.
Yes. He probably is one of the people who invented modern ballet, in a way. He was certainly one of the pioneers. No, not even that. But he certainly promoted it and made it a reality.
How about touring? I'm thinking about a dancer practicing. Is it difficult? I mean, you're moving around. And
if it's well organized, there's no difficulties at all.
You've got rehearsal halls
sure.
to practice.
Sure. We arrive and the theater is prepared, and if the stage is busy or there's no studios, then we have a studio arranged. If it's badly prepared, of course, you come, there's nothing, and it's confusion and chaos, and everyone gets upset.
So I'm talking about it. My next question was, ever have any nightmare experiences where you don't have hotels, you've got a show that night?
Seldom. But anybody who tours or travels can have this.
The show goes on.
Yeah.
Okay, so you're dancing with Béjart,
yeah.
a big company, and as mm-hmm. I said, a company that many dancers would kill mm-hmm. to dance in, and you're, during this point, not satisfied with just performing. You're getting into choreography.
Yes.
And yes. What did you do about that?
Well, I mean, Beja did all the choreography. It was impossible to do anything with him. So we developed what first just became performances that we would organize and structure. That's me and some friends. And doing this would give us the opportunity to choreograph something. So we would choreograph a piece of, say, 5 or 10 minutes, 15, very short usually. And then we would take some short excerpts from Béjar's repertoire or somebody else's repertoire. And we would put it together with, say, we'd be up to anywhere from 5 dancers to 15, depending on the situation, who was available. And we called ourselves Ballet Sans Frontières.
Ballet and Sans Frontières, Ballet Without Frontières. Why the title?
Well, it sounds good, and it is, in a way, it's exactly that's what we wanted to do. Sort of a thing without any limit.
Right.
Not trying to sound particularly ambitious, or but right. without limit in the sense that we can, like, bring in those people, or those people can come with us this time, or there's not a structure, let's say.
So you now you're choreographing and also getting into direction?
Yes.
And admin?
Yes. Well, as often happens in theater and dance especially, we wanted to choreograph, or we want to dance or do our own thing. Now, there's no money, or there's very little money, so we had to do a lot of other things ourselves, which involved finding a theater and organizing travel and all other aspects of management and preparation for the performance besides the actual choreography and dancing, which we wanted to do.
So you're learning on the job.
Yes, this is when it would actually start. Any ideas of management or administration, whatever, happened quite by accident, as it was, we were obliged to do it. You know, it was often dealing with fairly complex arrangements and actually fair amounts of money occasionally.
A good grounding, good experience.
Yes, yes, made a lot of mistakes. A lot of mistakes.
Well,
I really didn't know what I was doing, you know, besides what seemed to be the best ideas.
Okay, we're going to move on fairly quickly here, Michael, because you know the half hour goes by quite quickly. So after Ballet Sans Frontières and leaving Béjar, your next stop was Germany, was it not?
Right. I went to Germany
and
sort of was a guest dancer, and I choreographed a piece of Maurice Ravel's Bolero.
Now that was a major work.
Yeah, it was my first really larger production involving more dancers and more people.
How would you approach a piece like that, a work on that scale?
Well, as I do in all the pieces, you study the music, why he wrote the music, what the music's supposed to say, the history of the man, any sort of information I can get a hold of which involves that piece of music. This is particularly when the music is given.
Right.
You know, it's not me choosing it. And then you look, you hear it, you play it a great deal, you really get to know that music, and then you interpret it in what you believe. After you have assimilated all this information, then one tries to be creative and
Do you ever go the other way, start with an idea first and then look for music to...
Yeah, when I was younger, or let's say when I was beginning choreography, I used to do that a great deal, have some idea which I thought was very important to the world or some such thing, and then look for music. But this was extremely difficult, as one never found the right music to fit on.
Okay, so now where are we? We're in Germany.
Yes, Germany only lasted a year.
And after Germany?
I went to Austria, and I was in Austria 3 years, choreographing and let's say the whole business of running a company becomes more running a company,
administration,
directing a company.
Directing,
it's more, how can you say?
Difficult and challenging, two words that come to my mind.
Let's say, in Austria it was the first time we have an organized company with the dancers we choose, and we decide on a line. It's the first real situation where I can say I had a position of direction, running a company, and developing a line. It's very different than the things I was doing before.
Now we're moving on to Austria?
That is Austria.
Oh, this
Austria
is Linz.
In Linz.
And after Austria came Switzerland.
No.
Okay.
I went to Italy. And in Italy, I met a woman who has a school, and they decided to start a company. So we decided we'd do it together. And we started a small company, we called it Balletto di Toscana, which means Ballet of Toscana. And we started really in a garage. It's very cold in the winter and very hot in the summer. And then we built a company up, which I only stayed there really for 4 years, but we built it up over that time. And it's a very good company, and it's traveling all over the world now.
Must make you
feel
very
proud. Very well. Yes, because it was a very difficult thing to do, especially in Italy. Italy is very disorganized and very passionate, and people are very enthusiastic, but it's occasionally very difficult to get anything done. As you know, the people, they're very enthusiastic, they'll do anything, but they won't always do it today.
You know? Well, obviously you did get something done. You got a company that's traveling worldwide now,
yeah.
So you succeeded. Yes. After Italy, you got a contract to go to Switzerland.
Yes.
And there you were running a company?
Yes, Switzerland, I took a company in what is Bern, Switzerland. It's in the German half. It's German speaking. And it was the artistic director for what is called the Stadttheater, which is something similar to the Queen Elizabeth, I suppose, in Vancouver.
So again, a very demanding job, and that actually is what you've just come from.
Yes.
And you'll be going back to tie up loose ends and hopefully coming back to Vancouver to share your expertise and experience with us.
Yes, that's
and it. I'm saying this right now because would you believe our time's up?
Yeah, sure.
And I would just like to thank you once again for coming down and sharing all of this with us. And we'll look for you all over.
All right.
Okay, thanks again, Michael.
All right.
And I'd also like to take this opportunity to thank Andersons for providing this beautiful setting for the interviews. For Contact, I'm Gloria Creighton. Please join us again next time.